What's up, everyone, and welcome back to another season of Culture Cut TV. Super excited to be here after a long hiatus. Two, 3 years? It's been a few years since we last did this.
There's been a lot that's happened in between, and you know, now we're finally in this new facility. Brand new cameras, even more high def for y'all. We have a great new staff working here for us, and we're over at
28 Broadway, down in Lower Manhattan, Sound Collective. We're here in this nice facility. As Rich was saying, we have a lot of updates. For those of you who aren't familiar, my name is Josh, aka Static Link, and I'm with my man, Rich Furniss, who, if you watched older episodes of Culture Cut, recently had a name change.
I did indeed. We're going to dive into that a little bit later during the interview, but going by Rich Furniss now, and you know, ready for this new journey.
So for those of you who are new to Culture Cut TV, so basically how the format is, we usually have a guest artist that comes in. That guest artist picks a few music videos that influences them, and they talk about them.
Yeah, we go ahead and we talk about the music videos, we interview them, we find out why those music videos have really inspired them. I feel like as growing up, you know, music videos really inspired our generation and our culture so much, being able to fuse the music with visuals, bring creativity to a whole nother world.
Totally. Totally.
And you know me, being a video and music person, I've always connected very heavily with music videos. We're also going to go ahead and share some of our favorite music videos that have just recently come out that are inspiring us now and today.
Yes. So let's go ahead and get right into it. We're going to start with my video pick of the day. So right now, actually, I just released a record earlier this week.
Woo!
It's called Midnight. Pretty excited about it. And it's an instrumental album with a lot of sounds heavily influenced by The Alchemist and an artist he's working with who goes by Boldy James. This is Flight Risk right here on Culture Cut TV.
Chickity check it.
Cheer. Sergio, no Ticini, plug Dugiani, nigga, no Versace. Still serving blow out the guinea, stepping on the coke like a pair of Rachis. And it's busy running up a check with them 36s and them RKLs. Heard that nigga tell a lot of shark tales, and I'm really not that impressed. Me and 38 off of Earth deal, caught a birdie flake in the jar seal. Now I'm in the rave, flicking like a starfield, checking in at the phone blue. Tied in, I got drug ties, me and
damn, yo, that music video was fire. I love the beat. I definitely see how it influenced you and how it's very much like your style. So tell me a little bit about like why you picked this this track. Why did it resonate with you?
So yeah, so I mean, you know, obviously there's been this crazy resurgence of boom bap hip hop.
Let's be honest, like kind of what we grew up on, and like a very, for me at least, and it's different for everybody, a golden age of hip hop music.
Very true, and it's interesting because for those of you aren't familiar, and it'd be kind of crazy. There's a huge resurgence with a specific record label called Griselda Records right now.
Oh yeah, we have a couple friends who are signed to the label.
Yeah, we do. Rome Streets, shout out to Rome Streets, who was on Culture Cut in season 2.
Check out some of those previous seasons. Woo!
So we had some heavy hitters on there, but he's signed to Griselda Records now, and he's getting his shine, which is well overdue. But this particular record, this artist, Boldy James, he's from Detroit. I'm originally from Ohio. I moved to New York back in 2014. And, you know, Boldy has kind of come up through the ranks and basically been working with Alchemist. I'm a huge Alchemist fan. He's a major influence to me.
Me as well, for sure.
Yeah, man. So this kind of hear them working together. And this record's really dark, man. And you know, for me particularly, my music itself is very emotional, very, very dark stuff.
What I was going to say is I feel like it's very cinematic. And I feel like that era of music and that style of music has that cinematic feel to it where it kind of takes you on a journey. You
very
know?
True. Yeah. And I think that's something that I try to capture myself, you know, particularly when I'm working in the studio. I love big sounds, you know, in addition to, you know, Alchemist. I'm hugely influenced by like Dr. Dre. Justice League is another one I'm really
for
big
sure.
fan of. Big strings, horns, like the Rick Ross sound with Maybach music. That's kind of like my whole thing. So yeah, man, I mean, this particular sound, even though it's a record from today, that just recently came out a couple months ago, it really captured the essence of the kind of creative juices I've been on lately.
You know? Absolutely. So I know that you just released like a new project. You've been doing a lot of stuff with the sample pack world. You want to talk a little bit more about the new project and what's kind of gotten you into working on the sample packs?
Yeah. So for those of you that are familiar with the older episodes, a lot has changed in this short period of time. So
I think your music style has changed a lot, and I think that you've become more mature as an artist, and you've kind of really focused yourself in a direction, which I think is really positive.
Yeah, so around the time when we started Culture Cut TV, I'd been getting, you know, I was in a group called Static Link, And the one of the other members, Dan Dwyer, who's one of my good friends, he decided to part ways, and you know, left me kind of in my own realm to decide the future of what we wanted, what I wanted to do with Static Link. And you know, when we first started shooting the show, it was a lot of me experimenting with live instrumentation. I was doing a lot of hip hop centered stuff, but I really wasn't getting into like creating other music for other producers to use. It was still me trying to shop beats to artists, trying to put out music with other artists.
Which can be kind of a crazy grind.
It is. It's a very crazy grind. And to be honest with you, for me, I saw an opportunity and thought to myself, okay, you know, I feel like I'm making music for other producers. I had a lot of producers hitting me up saying the beats were fire, whatever. And I, you know, a lot of them were saying like, how'd you do this? How'd you do that? And so for me, I basically was like, okay, I'm gonna start trying to make music for producers.
Yeah.
You know? And so there's an artist who goes by Frank Dukes. He's an amazing artist. He has a library called Kingsway Music Library. Mm-hmm. And it was a big influence for me because Frank was kind of the first one to make these vintage sounds for other artists to sample. And he's worked with Drake and Kanye and a lot of big artists. And I thought to myself, I'm like, yo, I could totally do this too, you know?
Do you kind of see now a lot of a change in the music industry with these sample packs and a lot of people making, because I mean, you see so many different samples, sample sites. I mean, Splice being a big one that I know that everybody uses and stuff. I think that the age of sampling and resampling has kind of really come full circle in a way.
100%. You know, I think the reason we see it more now is music has become more accessible to everyone. And
for
that's
sure.
A beautiful thing. I think everybody deserves the right to express themselves, whether that's through playing an instrument, chopping up samples, DJing, it doesn't matter. You know, it's just a way to express themselves, and I love that. And I think with all these different sites that have been coming, like you mentioned Splice, sounds.com is another mm-hmm. one. And then more recently, Tracklib, a lot of artists are able to download material, make music, express themselves to that with that material, and they don't necessarily have to be like a crazy great musician, right?
Yeah.
Just able to create content quick. And I think also us living in the social media realm now where you need to be putting out stuff all the time.
Constantly.
We're gonna talk about this particularly with you because I know you deal with this as a producer and DJ yourself, but you can't really take a break. You know what I mean? You have to be putting out new content. People digest that content a lot quicker now. And so, you know, I think that's another reason that samples are so big is because basically you already doing half the work. And I think that's why you're also hearing more collaborations on songs.
I think that's a big one for me as well. And I think you really touched a point that I loved is like, it allows people to express themselves in a different way. You don't necessarily need to know how to play the guitar or the trumpet or whatever. You can pull somebody else's pieces, spark off of their ideas, and then be able to build something on your own. And I think that's really how I became a producer in a big way, was by sampling other people's music and like finding a way for me to flip a song in a way that no one else would have expected. And then I think as you get older, and I think what you started doing as well was like resampling yourself and taking stuff from other songs and doing it. And I think that's kind of part of everybody's musical journey, or not everybody's, but a lot of people's musical journey is kind of finding that.
Sure. Yeah. And you know, the other side of that coin is I started off sampling, you know, mm-hmm. And so I was heavily influenced by like Jay Dilla, obviously, and Dr. Dre.
The GOATs.
Yeah, man. And, you know, I was really into like other Detroit legends like Black Milk, stuff like that, that are amazing producers that are sampling heavily. And that actually made me want to learn to play the instruments too. So after I would, you know, work with somebody that might play a bass line, I got to experience the other side of that, where sometimes you're waiting for that bass line for a week and then 2 weeks.
I've been in that position many times.
Exactly. So then that influenced me to try to learn to play the instruments, because I was like, oh, I'm relying on this person a lot. So it not only does allow you to create music and put stuff out quickly and collaborate and get different points of views, but for me, it also influenced me to learn new things and learn how to create and find my niche, you know, because I think what happens a lot is you have a situation where like, you start to get stale, you know what I mean? And you want to try to push yourself forward and find something else that's really going to like make you stick out amongst everyone else, you know?
Absolutely.
And for me, that was like horns. Like for me, I think a lot of the stuff that I do is very horn-centric.
I remember when you first started that horn journey and, you know, learning the trumpet first, and now
saxophone.
I feel like you play every brass instrument almost.
Yeah, so I went back to school, you know, I did some study at Juilliard and Berkeley to try to learn horn arrangement, learn composition, and so I can bring that into the realm of hip-hop.
Yeah.
And now that's warranted me the ability to work with artists that are some of my idols, you know what I mean? And to be able to do that and have them sample my material and tell me, this is why I sampled you, and understanding that journey from over the past 2 or 3 years has got me to this point. You know, it's really, it's
where I would put you at, because I'm nerd culture, I think that you're a full stack musician.
Hey, there we go. A little engineering term there. I like it, man. I like it. Well, you want to get into the next video?
Yeah, so my video is a little bit different than Josh's. I don't know, I feel like this song dominated the summer this year. Purple Disco Machine featuring the Knox. I don't know, I've been fortunate enough to meet the Knox, you know, hang out with a lot of those guys. Amazing musicians. I think that this is a masterpiece musically, great bass line, which is something that always drives me. And talking about the image going with the video, it's a very different music video, and I really love the concept that they went with it. They went full concept with it. It has dancing, which I feel like goes with the TikTok trend. There's a dance that can go with it. They went ahead and tied in like a superhero vibe with it, which I feel like with all the superhero movies coming out. And then they kind of created like this versus of like the millennials versus, or the baby boomers versus the next generation. And I just really like the approach they took with it and then how they tied it all together at the end. The Knox have always had phenomenal music videos. I'm always a fan of what they do. They're fully theatrical, and the music to go with it, disco vibes. We're about to find out a little bit more. It has been definitely my wave recently. I don't know, I just think it's a phenomenal song, the way they tied the visuals and the music together. So we're gonna look at the Knox, Purple Disco Machine, Fireworks. Chickity check it.
It's amazing.
How dope is that video?
So good, man. It's interesting. It actually touched on like it's a cool concept. Like you said, especially like having the elements of TikTok and how that's changed.
Yeah,
too.
For sure.
Like having a dance because they know TikTok is such a big part of music culture now.
Exactly.
And social media. That's.
I think
it makes
songs go viral now, and it's funny how just like somebody dancing on the internet can make a song just go that crazy.
Man, and rebirth songs too, because there's a lot of old songs that are being brought back up. During the TikTok trend that have kind of are seeing a second light now.
Absolutely,
like,
yeah.
I think I heard, what was it, You're a Jerk?
Yeah.
Blowing up again, which is crazy, you know what I mean? So that kind of thing, it's just interesting. Oh, well, more importantly, man, I want to point out something that is different than normal. So normally you see this man behind the turntables, and today he's sitting in a chair because different than what we normally do, we usually have a guest on and Rich is handling the turntable duties, but we want to hear about why or what happened from Mop Top to Rich Furniss, the reasons for the change, and where are you at now?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a good question. I think a big thing for me is part of this musical journey that I've been on, I think I was always afraid to put myself forward. And I think that Mop Top in a big way was a mask that I put on whenever I would DJ or whenever I'd work on music, because I think part of it honestly was I didn't really feel confident enough in where I was musically or in what I was doing. And I always had this alter ego that I could go to where it wasn't, oh, it's Ricky hanging out or it's Rich hanging out. It's Mop Top. Mop Top's wilding. Mop Top's going crazy. Yeah. Mop Top's at the club giving shots and giving out glasses of water that are actually just vodka.
That does happen, by the way. It was always a caution. You always had to put an asterisk whenever you're hanging next to...
Double check it.
Yeah.
I think over the pandemic really was a big time for me. And it happened right before the pandemic. I don't think just the pandemic was a big part of it, but I feel confident enough, I think, in myself now where I wanted to put myself on the front stage. And I wanted to become more than just an open format DJ. You know, when I was coming up in college, I was starter DJs. And then I was Mop Top when I was alone because I didn't necessarily feel comfortable. And now I feel comfortable enough to be like, no, this is me and this is the music that I love. I think it really brought me back in a large way to my roots. And where I found myself as a DJ and a musician, I think, was in Chicago. And anybody who knows the history of house music, you know, house music was birthed in Chicago, in the warehouse of Chicago, Frankie Knuckles, all of that. And it's something that has always resonated with me. Anybody who knows me, I'm a high energy type of person. I love to dance, I love to have fun, and I love high energy and I love chaos. And being able to come back now and work on disco projects with my group Passé was like, wow, this is something that I really love. And unfortunately, you know, that project kind of paused for the time being with Anthony being in France and being throughout Europe, that I was like, I really want to push this music. So over the pandemic, I went ahead and I put together like 4 full songs, and I was making a new song every day, not finishing, but making a new beat every day to hone my skills back in and really gain the confidence I needed to come full force. And it just felt appropriate once I did that to go by Rich Furniss, because this is a project that I believe in. I think this is a culmination of everything that I've learned in the damn near 2 decades of me, you know, DJing and being part of music. And I'm just really proud of the project. I'm really excited about the music that I'm going to be putting out over the next, hopefully, the rest of my lifetime. It is a rebirth, definitely.
Because essentially you're kind of taking and restarting, but building it on the wisdom and knowledge that you've gained over time to get to that point.
I think that's the whole thing. I wish that I had this knowledge back in college and back in high school when I was first started DJing. But now with this rebrand as Rich Furniss, you know, being able to be smarter with the moves I make, smarter with the promotion, the branding that I create with all of it, and then take all of the contacts and knowledge that I've used to really be able to push this project full steam ahead. And, you know, I'm really proud of it.
Sure, man. I mean, I've heard it. The records sound great. I mean, I know you've been doing a lot. You've been putting out releases kind of nonstop. Production value-wise, I mean, everything always sounds great. And I know you've actually gotten to some sound design and stuff lately, too.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's a big thing. I mean, I think me as a musician, I think I'm less of a classical musician like yourself. Like, I don't play every instrument, but where I advance is, I think, in the technology around music. You know, I love technology, and you know, you do as well in different ways. And I think creating that solid sound design and using the DAW and all of the VST plugins and stuff to really craft the sound and manipulate and make things that maybe other people wouldn't, you know? And even how I design my melodies and my chords and stuff, it wouldn't be in a traditional way that I would think as a musician. I use a lot of technology to help me and to help craft those sounds and build them the way that I want them to be.
Well, I think you point out something that's important there, right? It doesn't really matter the what you use to create, right?
Yeah.
I think that's something that's really important to point out to everyone listening, is it doesn't matter if you can play a million instruments or you play 0 instruments. It's just about being able to express yourself in a way that you appreciate, and it helps you relax and kind of put yourself out there, you know, and expose yourself. Because I mean, there's amazing artists too that play instruments that do house music, and there's also artists who create hip hop beats who can't play any instruments. It goes both ways, yeah. You know. So I think it just doesn't really matter, like, you know, how you do it. It's just as long as you do it your way.
I think that's it. I think that's why I liked your whole, you know, comment on the sample packs and stuff. And I think that's part of why I never really had the confidence, was because I looked at so many amazing musicians around me. You know what I mean? Yourself. We had Lefty in the studio earlier. I've just been surrounded by so many great people. You know, John, Morrissey, all these guys who are just really good musicians. And I never felt like I could stack myself up. I mean, Anthony even. I mean, he's probably one of the most insane keyboardists I've ever met.
It's true.
But I think, like you said, owning the fact that that's not my strong suit, but I can still express myself a different way and get my art out there by the means that I'm able to, you know, show myself and project myself.
Sure. Yeah. And that's great, man. I mean, you found your niche, which sounds awesome. Well, I'm looking forward to hearing more from you as this continues to grow. And you guys will obviously be seeing much more of us as this time goes on. Do you want to get into this last video?
Yeah, let's do it. So this last video is a good friend. He's absolutely crushing right now. Just did a label with Payday Records. First people who signed Jay-Z. Mm-hmm. They had
DJ Premier,
legendary New York City hip hop label. He went ahead and produced a track with all of the collabs.
He's also a really good Warzone player for all my video game heads out there.
This is very real.
We played with him a few times.
So. We squatted up with him very heavily over the pandemic when there was nothing else to do, and all
very
we had
true.
To look forward to was 10 p.m. Warzone games.
That's right. Exactly right. Yeah.
So this collabs with Joey Perp, Chance the Rapper, Young Bane. The track's called Winners. They went and they did the music video in London. The whole team flew out to London, and they really just shot it on these handy cams of just their adventures in London for 24
so cool.
hours.
It's a very cool video.
Cool concept, and I really love to see this new lo-fi move going with like videos. I think videos have gotten so crispy, so clean. Everybody's used to just these high def videos. And now we're seeing resurgence with YouTubers, with music videos, all of this going back to lo-fi, even photographers shooting on film again.
Music.
It's a really cool thing to
the
see.
Music too is going back to lo-fi.
Going back to lo-fi. Us emulating all of the old amps and stuff like that. Everything secular.
Simulation. Yeah, all that. Yep.
So this is our boy Smoko Ono with Chance the Rapper, Young Bane, Joey Perp, Winners. Chickity check it.
Let's go.
Do you realize I ain't the same as these guys? Check. They try to ride a wave, got lost in all my space. I've been skating all night, grinding night and day, just so we make it rain. Make it rain in any weather, counting money in our laughter. We not in a no passer. I just light up my rasta. I drink my Hennessy straight.
Ooh, my man Smoko crushing it.
Fire.
Yeah.
Fire, man. I mean, obviously Chance. You got Chance on there, Young Bane. Like, all these guys, man, it's awesome too. Like, I actually like the Handycam thing.
Yeah.
The cuts too are interesting because it kind of is a little chaotic, but that's what makes it like really cool, you know?
I had said before, I love the chaos, and to see that, it just feels very raw. I feel like I'm on this adventure in London with them, which I really like. And just like, you see them like pulling up in the van in some random kitchen. It's just like, it seemed like that video must have been a blast to shoot.
Yeah, a lot of fun, a lot of fun. Well, we hope to see you guys in the future. We have a lot of excellent guests that are scheduled to come on the show here. Shout out to Sound Collective. Again, we're here at 28 Broadway in the Financial District of Manhattan at this beautiful location in school. Not only is it a school, but there's a plethora of stuff to do here. We have
a lot of toys
rooms,
to play with.
A lot of toys to play with. Behind our screen here, there's actually a full stage with drums and a bass guitar.
We do a lot of performances here.
A lot
we
of
have
performances.
Some seminars happening. Workshops.
That's right. And you can come and be a member of the space and become part of our community. You can contact Sound Collective to learn more. Just check out soundcollective.com and you can contact admissions through there. If you're interested in taking any classes, we have multiple different ways for you to learn here at the school. You can take online classes or in-person classes through private lessons. We have a music entrepreneur certificate that'll take you through each individual step that it takes to be a self-employed musician.
It's fire.
And
I wish there was something like that when I was coming up.
Me too. Anything from DJing to being a bass guitar, keyboardist, whatever it is, we got you covered. Or if you want to learn at your own speed, we have a massive, massive library of videos that are available on the Sound Collective platform. And we have live classes in our Sunrise sessions as part of our subscription service. For only $25 a month, you can take classes live with some of our leading instructors that are Grammy Award winners and just playing out killing it in the music industry.
True.
All right, so we hope to see you on the next Culture Cut. I'm Static Link.
Your boy Rich Furniss.
We'll see you soon.